right, good to see everybody here tonight. Welcome to the midweek service. Grab a songbook. We'll start by singing together. Number 490. Revive Us Again, 490. Let's stand together to sing. Everybody standing, and Brother Bob will lead us. 490.
We praise Thee, O God, for the Son of
what Wednesday night ought to do. Amen. Put a little spark back in us and get us charged up, ready to go through the rest of the week. All right. Good to see you here tonight. Looking forward to what the Lord will have in store for us, and appreciate you being here on Wednesday evening. Let's open with prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, we bow before you tonight. We thank you, Lord, for another opportunity for us to be together here in the house of God. Lord, we're asking you to do just what we sang tonight, that you'd revive us again. Fill each heart with your love, and may each soul be rekindled with fire from above. Father, bless the music tonight, our fellowship together, the prayer time. Lord, I pray that everything that done this evening will be for your glory and for your honor, that you'll be pleased with the service tonight. Use it in our lives to make us more like Christ. Lord, have your will and way now in this service tonight, and I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, you may be seated.
Turn, please, to number 321. 3, 2, 1. Sound the battle cry. See the foe is nigh. Raise the standard high for the Lord. 3, 2, 1. Let's sing that first all together.
Sound the battle cry. See the foe is nigh. Raise the standard high for the Lord. Gird your armor on. Stand firm, everyone. Rest your
missionary letter from the Bolos, but we're going to postpone that for a week. Brother Moreland is here this evening, and he leaves Friday for about, 17 days or so, June 12th through the 29th. He's going over to Armenia and going to be in a pastor's conference there. And I want him to come and say a little bit about the trip and tell us what we could specifically pray for as he goes on this trip, and what they'll be doing, and how we can effectively pray for him while he's gone over these next couple weeks. All right? So, Brother Moreland, you share with us, if you would, please.
First of all, I just want to thank you guys for your prayers and your support with everything that's been going on. I'll be leaving Friday. We'll be flying out of Cincinnati to JFK, through Moscow, and down to Yerevan, Armenia. We'll be there for 2 weeks. I'm going down with a group from First Bible International, and I personally will be teaching the national pastors about the importance of the Bible, which I'm sure they know, but we'll be going over that, and then the importance of Bible translation. One of the things that we're going to try to do is try to make some good contacts with these men in Armenia. One of the problems that we're having is that there's been a lot of Americans going over there promising certain things and never following through with it. So we're going in to a group of men that's excited that we're coming, but what we're trying to do is make some good contacts, because we want to go back. We want to help these men. One of the things I think what we're trying to do is maybe start a school over there, a small Bible institute, and then training these men how to be Bible translators also. We're looking for some men to help us in some of these languages that do not have a Bible. One of the languages I'm looking for is called Azerbaijani South language. And the church up in Brother Kohler's church up in Loudonville, Ohio, has adopted the country of Iran and adopted three people groups. And one of the people groups, that's their main language, is Azerbaijani South. And now listen to this. It reaches 19 people groups in 9 different countries, and this hits 20% of Iran. So, and that's one of the languages that these men in Armenia speak. And some of them speak that as a second language. So can you imagine what we could do if we could find some good Christian, saved, faithful men that we can help show them how to translate, and they can help us, and we can get a Bible into that language. And we're talking about millions and millions and millions of people. And that's huge. And that's what we're supposed to be doing as Christians. You know, too much is given, much is required. You know, so that this is something that this, as a church, this is what we need to be doing. And so we're very excited. Just pray for us, pray for a safe trip, for our safety. And the other men that are going to be there preaching, they're preaching on church planting, tithing, some things about marriage. And, you know, we're just going through a whole thing. And we're just praying. We're going to be in 3 different areas of Armenia. So please just pray for us. We're very excited about this, and just pray that we get some good contacts, that the Lord will put some people in our pathway. All right, thank you.
If you'll jot some of those things down and be praying for him on the trip and for the conference I'll have over there with the pastors. All right. Got a prayer sheet? Take your prayer guide out. Anybody need one tonight? Slip your hand up. The usher will get you one. Anybody? Right down here in the front row, Gage. Why don't you jump up and go get it, Gage? Right down that aisle. Oh, Brett gave him his. You right there. Oh, you got an extra one? Okay, well, Pete's here now. You all right? You came all that way, and he took care of it. All right. Thank you, Brother Pete. All righty. We'll start on the back, as usually do, with the coming events, and we're praying for the prison tomorrow night and the RU inside that goes on there, and then Friday night, Reformers Unanimous right here at the church from 7 to 9 p.m. And got the new banner up and new sign out front. Doesn't that look good? And that is really eye-catching, I think, and really a good thing. And I'm glad to see that up, and appreciate Brother Bob Reed taking care of that. And I think some other guys helped him get in the ground. Mike might have had something to do with that too. So we appreciate you guys doing that. Saturday the 13th for our soul winning and bus visitation at 10 a.m. And be out for that, and we continue to follow up on folks from our fair that we had. And then Ladies Night Out, June 15th, with Ann Morland, your speaker. And ladies, there's a sign-up sheet for that downstairs. And please sign up for that and make that a wonderful night for yourselves. And then the 20th will be the Father-Son Barbecue at 5 o'clock. And Brother Jarvis is going to be sharing with us that night. And excited to good to have him back. He got home earlier this morning from Honduras and had a exciting time after getting back in the States and unable to land in Atlanta for storms and such, and got diverted to Mobile, Alabama, where they sat on the runway because Mobile, Alabama has no customs and you can't get off the airplane. And so they sat there until they got the green light to fly to Atlanta and land, and then he had to wait to get a plane to Columbus, and I think it was after 1 a.m. before he finally landed. And so he's here. He's not sure what day it is, but he's here, and it's good to have him home, and we'll look forward to hearing what the Lord did there down in Honduras. He was down there helping his son Adam, who will be in our missions conference in September, and we'll look forward to hearing what the Lord did there, Brother Jack. I'm glad you're home safely. Amen. All right. On the inside, the praise reports. Thankful that Jenny was baptized on Sunday, and praise the Lord for that. 40 at the CRC last week on Thursday night, and 10 men received Christ as their Savior. And there were 20 at the nursing home service on Sunday afternoon. And again, appreciate that ministry. Up above, underneath the health, you want to right beside Rose Hamner, that's Heather Barham's grandmother. She went home to be with the Lord this morning. And so pray for the Barham family, and as they make the arrangements now for the services and such, and we'll try to get that word out to folks as we know what it is. And I know that Heather and Mary Wharton and others would appreciate your prayers for them at this time. All right. And a couple above that there, Heather Joy Heaton, her shoulder to heal up. She's got a torn rotator cuff and torn labrum, and she's going to start physical therapy for that on Monday. Keep her in prayer. And then if you'll add a name there, put Krista Barridge, B-A-R-R-I-D-G-E. This is Krista's, Jack and Sherry's daughter, married daughter up in Michigan. And she's 16 and a half weeks pregnant and having some issues right now. And she's in the hospital right now, but it's she's had her first pregnancy after several miscarriages, and so very concerned about some issues she's having right now. So please keep Krista in prayer, would you please? And really, I know they would appreciate that, and I know she would as well. Okay. Praying for those in authority, and of course our military, and those who are battling cancer, and pray for these on the salvation list, that the Lord will continue to work and we'll see them come to know Christ their Savior. Pray for the unreached people groups of the world, and what you pray for is not just for these folks, but you're praying for God to send laborers to these people to reach them with the gospel. What did he say? Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. So we're praying for laborers to go and answer God's call to reach these folks with the gospel. And then of course our missionaries, and especially let's remember Brother Moreland as he sets out on his trip to Armenia on Friday. Okay. Brother Taylor, you've been gone for a while. I'm gonna have you come up and pray for us tonight. Okay. And he'll lead us in our prayer this evening, and as he leads us audibly, you pray along with him silently. That's how you stay connected when you're praying, and you don't let your mind wander off and do other things. As he calls it out, you call it out, or you just say it to yourself, and you talk to the Lord along with him as he leads us in prayer tonight.
Before I get started in prayer, I just wanted to give an update. I didn't have a chance to give the pastor this card. The name on the list here under cancer. So a very old and dear friend of mine, Lindsey Parker, he's been on this list for cancer. And he called me just this afternoon. And this old boy, he's a saved man. He's always praising the Lord. But today he was shouting because the doctor told him his cancer is all gone. He's got none. Yeah, praise God. Yes. That doctor told him, you may die of a different kind of cancer, but that cancer is gone. And he gave all the glory to God, too. He made sure that doctor knew it. Yeah. Okay, let's go to prayer. Dear Father, Lord, we do thank you for making that way, Lord, that we can come straight to that mercy seat of yours, Lord, and bring our petitions before you. Thank you for making that way possible through your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, as we start this night out, all these names, Lord, week after week, we bring them before you, and knowing that you hear our requests, and that we can leave them with you, knowing that however it turns out, whichever direction it goes, Lord, that you do all things well. Sometimes the answers aren't what we want to hear, but we know that there's nobody that knows the end of the matter other than you, Lord. I pray that through these trials that others would seek you. It seems like in the hard times that is when people draw closer to you. They realize the futility and the helplessness of the situations that they have, Lord. And without you, it's all for naught. Lord, I thank you for this RU Inside, this prison ministry. All those guys there, Lord, that we meet week after week, that you prepare the hearts before we even go. And we thank you for all the lost souls that you've given us thus far, Lord. Using us as the servants that go in there, but it's you that give the increase, Lord, and we know it. But we thank you for it. Many of them are at the bottom, Lord, and there's nowhere to look other than you. So we go in there and give them the word, Lord. And we just ask for continued help in the finances, Lord, and that you supply the needs there through your servants, Lord. And Lord, this reform is unanimous on Fridays, Lord. Others come in here from the streets, Lord, with problems. And we thank you again for the laborers and the ones that are workers here and that's willing to give up their time and the sacrifice, Lord, to help the others that are in need. Bring them to the truth, the only truth, Lord. That's you. Pray for the Soul Winners bus ministry, Lord, on Saturdays, and pray that this bus ministry would continue to grow, bringing in the children, Lord, that they would have a chance to hear about you and use them to bring in the parents. Pray for all the upcoming events, Lord, that others would have an opportunity to fellowship and hear your gospel. Lord, I thank you for the lost soul and thank you for Jenny following you in baptism this past Sunday, Lord. Another obedient Christian, Lord, to the precepts that you have set out. Lord, thank you for this nursing home ministry, Lord, and the laborers there too, and the opportunity for the majority of these folks, Lord, that's at the end of their lives and still having an opportunity to hear about Jesus. Thank you that there's laborers willing to go there in that field as well. Pray for all these ministries here at this church, Lord. So many to stand here and name, Lord, but each and every one of them, you know our needs. You know how much we need you in every one of these areas, Lord. I just pray that your mighty hand would be in there as well. And all these on the health list, Lord, Father, thank you for taking home this Rose Hamner, Lord, and your mercy. We thank you for the going home that she's had. Be with the family, Lord. It's a sorrowful time when we lose a loved one, Lord. I know you wept at Lazarus' grave. And you've suffered the same as all of us, Lord. So I just ask for you, giving them mercy and grace, Lord. For I know they mourn, but not as the world mourns. Father, I pray for Heather Joy and her shoulder. Pray for Krista Burridge, Lord, this pregnancy, Lord. And she's had issues in the past and having issues now, Lord. I just pray that you touch her body. Let no harm come to this baby. I pray that you help her and touch her body, Lord, and strengthen her. We leave that in your hands, and we thank you. Father, all those in authority in this country, Lord, from the mayor of Grove City and the mayors of the towns, and the governors, and plumb on up into our Congress and our president, Lord. Every one of them that's got authority, Lord, I pray that you would turn their hearts as the rivers of water, your word says, Lord. The hearts of the king is in your hand. And I pray that you touch every one of these, Lord, and that America would finally open up their eyes and know that we've got to get back to you. And not down this slippery road that we're on. Father, I pray that all these people will have a miraculous change of heart and turn towards you and make this a godly nation. And the Christians, give them the boldness, Lord, as a lion, to stand up to proclaim your name again. Pray for the military, Lord, that's serving our country, Lord, wherever they're at around tonight, Lord, give them peace and safety. Lord, many of them are away from home, over in foreign countries, Lord. And Americans or Christians are always the first to be there to help and seem like they're the first to be run down. But give them safety, Lord. Put someone in their path that if there's a lost one there, and I know there is, Lord, that they would come to know you, at least a chance to hear the gospel. All these folks on the cancer list, Lord, each and every one of them, I pray that today would be the healing that just like Lindsey Parker received. I pray that there would be many, every one of them on this list, Lord, that would have miracles. Yes. For I know that you're still a miracle working God, and nothing is too hard for you. Lord, salvation, each and every one of these on this list, Lord, and there's many others I know. I pray that every single one of them will have a miserable night. Let them come to know that there is a God that loves them, Lord, and that they'll have no peace tonight when they lay down their head, nor tomorrow, nor the next day, Lord, till they come to accept you, accept the free gift that you give them, Jesus Christ. All these unreached people groups, Lord, there's so many that this list doesn't contain enough room, Lord. But I pray for each and every group, Lord, that soon there would be a Bible for every language that's spoken out there, that they would be able to have a Bible in their hand that they could read the gospel, Lord. and that they would know in their own language and to be able to understand that there is a God that loves them. Pray for the Moreland family, Lord, along with all the rest of these missionaries. That you'd be with them. Give them health, give them safety in travel and safety everywhere they go, Lord. Give the family peace. Financial aid, Lord, that you use your willing vessels to supply the financial needs of these as they go around the world, proclaiming the name of Jesus Christ. Father, as we leave all these petitions at your feet, Lord, we thank you for making that way possible. Lord, be with the pastor tonight as he opens up the scriptures to us. And let each and every one of us be attentive to what you would have us to have, Lord. Help us to pay attention and let our minds not wander. To cease the interruptions, Lord, when he's speaking. And Lord, we'll give you all the praise, honor, and glory. May everything that's said and done here tonight be pleasing in thy sight. We thank you for all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, we want to take just a minute and welcome anybody visiting with us tonight. And anybody here tonight for the first time? Do you bring somebody with you? You got a couple back here? All right. Grace, you have some girls with you? Who do you have with you, Grace? All right, good to have you tonight, girls. Thank you for coming. And who is this in the middle? Oh, Michelle, good to have you tonight. Thank you. Good. And who's with you? Thank you. Who's with you? All right, great. Well, ladies, thanks for showing up tonight. That's wonderful. Glad you're here. Great. All right, thank you for coming. Stephanie has her gang in here tonight, huh? Some are yours and some are nephew and niece. Okay, very good. Fantastic. Good to see y'all. You fill a row up real good, don't you? All right, great. And if you'll take a minute, did they give you a visitor's card, a welcome card? Did they give that to you? You do have it. Good. If you'll take just a minute, we're going to sing a song. Go ahead and fill that out for us, if you wouldn't mind, please. And after the song, then, we'll have an offering, and you just put the card in the plate, if you would. Keep the pen as our gift to you for coming tonight. Ladies, we're glad you're here. That's great. And those two younger ladies beside you, too. All right. And thank you for being here. Let's give them a warm welcome, shall we? All right. They'll fill that out, but we'll sing together. 298. 298. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus, my Lord, will love me forever. You go ahead and stand and we'll sing. 298.
On that verse together. Jesus, my Lord, will love me forever. From him no power of evil can sever. He gave his life to ransom my soul. Now I belong to him. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Not for the years of time alone, but for eternity. Lifted me up from sorrow and shame. Now I belong to him. Now I belong to Jesus. Belongs to me. Not for the years of time alone, but for eternity.
Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Not for the years of time alone, but for eternity. Joy floods my soul, for Jesus has saved me, freed me from sin that long had enslaved. As you find your seats, let's sing that last all together. Joy floods my soul, for Jesus has saved me, freed me from sin that long had enslaved me. His precious blood he gave to redeem. Now I belong to him. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Not for the years of time alone, but for eternity.
All right, good singing. You can be seated. Ushers are coming. We'll get our offering tonight. And give as God's blessed and prospered you. And I did get a check yesterday in the mail for the prison ministry. And praise the Lord for that. And we'll be, Lord willing, going to have some training for some folks to get approved to go out to the London prison on June 24th, I think it is. And so that'll be completed, and then they'll get set. So it looks like a July start out there in London. And we're excited about that open door the Lord's given to us. And God, I already have, I think, somewhere in the neighborhood of 15 to 20 guys that are doing the program or have been through the program. We have several graduates that are in there out there at London, and they'll be able to continue with some of the course and be a help to us out there. But there's 2,400 inmates there, and what an opportunity. So we'll look forward to that and pray for that to all come together. Anytime you work with the state, it's not a real quick thing, and so it takes a little time, but we'll ask the Lord to expedite things a little bit for us. All right, let's pray for the offering tonight. Father, thank you for the privilege it's ours to give. Thank you, Lord, for being so giving to us and for loving us and for all that you do for us, Lord, and for just who you are. Lord, we love you. I pray we'll give out of a heart of love tonight. Bless the offering in Jesus' name. Amen. Take your Bible this evening, if you would. Deuteronomy chapter 10 is where we're going to start. Deuteronomy chapter 10. And we're going to talk tonight about God's place for providing His Word to every generation. God's place. Last week, we talked about God's plan for providing His Word to every generation. I want you to understand that these lessons on Wednesday night for these 4 weeks all go together. They all build one upon another. It's not one to just be on its own. So I want to encourage you to just make a note. You want to be here every single one and not miss out, or you're going to have a piece of the puzzle missing, all right? And we want you to be able to get it all and put it all together, and it'll, I think it'll all make sense to you when you see the finished product, all right? So we had God's plan, and that was oral publishing and inspirational publishing and then educational publishing of the Word of God. And tonight, we're going to look at two key elements in the area of God preserving His Word, and that is the place of His Word and also the process. And you're going to see that much care was given to ensure that we'd have an accurate translation of the Bible in every generation. All right? Let's pray together and we'll get into our study here tonight. Father, thank you for this evening. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity and privilege again that's ours to gather together here and to open up your precious word. And I pray, Lord, the Bible would be a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. And Lord, I pray that each of us would give our attention this evening and our full effort to study your word, that we would study to show ourselves approved unto God, workmen that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Lord, speak to our hearts tonight as we study your word. And Lord, impress upon us by your spirit that which is our responsibility in this matter. So help us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, I want you to look at, first of all, the place of preserving the Word of God then, all right, where it was. And that's Deuteronomy chapter 10, all right? Notice with me verse number 1, Deuteronomy 10, verse 1. At that time, the Lord said unto me, you these two tables of stone like unto the first, and come unto me into the mount, and make thee an ark of wood. And I will write on the table the words that were in the first tables which thou breakest, and thou shalt put them in the ark. And I made an ark of shittim wood, and hewed two tables of stone like unto the first, and went up into the mount, having the two tables in mine hand. And he wrote on the tables, according to the first writing, the Ten Commandments, which the Lord spake unto you in the mount out of the midst of the fire in the day of the assembly, and the Lord gave them unto me. And I turned myself and came down from the mount and put the tables in the ark which I had made. And there they be, as the Lord commanded me. So you notice as God begins to have a place of preserving his word then, you find out that the place, that the scriptures were kept in a prepared place. And we know that prepared place was the Ark of the Covenant. Now, that's not Noah's Ark, okay? This is the Ark of the Covenant. It was a small box thing. It wasn't even hardly 6 feet long and just a few feet wide. It was just a box that Moses made here to keep it in place. You can read about it. If you look in Exodus 25, you'll read about the Ark of the Covenant, and the testimony was there. Aaron's rod that budded was put in there, and a pot of the manna was put in there. And they kept that as a testimony. That's why it's called the Ark of the Testimony, and things that God did for them. But that's where he had the scriptures kept. So not only was it a prepared place, but you notice they're kept in a holy place. The Ark of the Covenant was holy to the Lord. It was set apart to God. You're going to find out. In fact, go ahead and look there. Look at Exodus 25. Would you turn there, please? Exodus chapter 25. Notice now here, God is describing the tabernacle and the Holy of Holies in the tabernacle. If you look, first of all, in the, verse number 13, he talks about the staves of shittim wood and overlay them with gold. Verse 14, thou shalt put the staves into the rings by the sides of the ark, that the ark may be borne with them. And the staves shall be in the rings of the ark, they shall not be taken from it. And thou shalt put into the ark of the testimony, ark the testimony which I shall give thee. And then thou shalt make a mercy seat of pure gold. 2 cubits and a half shall be the length thereof, 1 cubit and a half the breadth thereof. And then he talks about the cherubims that'll be over that, and the cherub on one end and the cherub on the other end in verse 20. Now look at verse 21. and thou shalt put the mercy seat above upon the ark. And in the ark thou shalt put the testimony that I shall give thee. And there I will meet with thee, and I will commune with thee from above the mercy seat between the two cherubims which are upon the ark of the testimony of all things which I will give thee in commandments unto the children of Israel. That's the Holy of Holies that's being described there, and that's where the presence of God was. And God says, that's where I'll meet with you. It was a holy place. And so the place that God had for his word then was a prepared place, the Ark of the Covenant, and it was a holy place. It was in the Holy of Holies, but wait a minute, it was also a safe place. It was also a safe place. And that place was with the priests of God. They were chosen by God to be the guardians of his precious word. And you find out, and we'll talk more about this group next week, but it was a group called the Kohathites, the sons of Aaron, and they had three sons, and one of those were the Kohathites, and they were in charge of the holy things. And we'll get in more about them next week, and you don't want to miss that. But they were the guardians of the Word of God. They were guardians of the precious words that God gave. And so they were responsible to preserve the text from error, but they were also responsible to copy it down for the next generation. Okay, that was God's word then. All right? Now, let's look at God's word now. Where's the place of preserving his word now? The process of the priests preserving the text from error and copying it for future generations, okay, that remained in place all throughout the Old Testament. That's how God had his word handled. But a miraculous event occurred that changed everything. Okay? And that miraculous event was the word became flesh and dwelt among us. John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the word was with God, and the word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. And we know then in verse 14, the word became flesh and dwelt among us. And so we know that word was Christ, and Christ became flesh and he dwelt among us. So Jesus, and by the way, what did Jesus do? He personified the perfect application of what the Old Testament looked like. Jesus said, I didn't come to destroy the law. I came to what? Fulfill it. He's the only one that could, and the only one that ever did. And so he added, and then he added what was written by speaking it and teaching it in person. He taught it to his followers. And then he gave us the command to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. We're to take that gospel to every single individual. And so we find out then those who put their faith in Jesus Christ as their Savior, you know what he did? He added that he added those people to a much larger group. It wasn't just to the Jew now. He added them once they received Christ their Savior. He puts them into a much larger group, and that group was called the church. Okay? This is the New Testament. This is those who believe and have faith in Christ and are baptized, and they're added to the church. And now the church comes into play. And God is going to use a different group of people as the revealer of himself to the world. His plan is always to reveal himself to the world. Now, the people he's going to use to do that is going to be the church. And by the way, who's the church? That's you and I, those who've received Christ as their Lord and Savior and obeying him in baptism and are serving him. So God had holy men of old begin to pen down the words as he spoke to them. Okay? They pinned down everything that God wanted man to know. Look at 2 Peter chapter 1. Would you look there, please? 2 Peter chapter 1. You get to Hebrews, and then there's James, and then after that's 1 Peter, and then there's 2 Peter. 2 Peter 1. Verse number 19. says, we have also a more sure word of prophecy. And let me just stop and say that more sure than what? You'll find out if you read that context, he's referring to when they heard the audible voice of God on the Mount of Transfiguration. And now the Spirit of God tells Peter, you have a more sure word of prophecy. More sure than the audible voice of God? Yes. Yes. Because now it's in writing. And you'll find out how more sure it is. Remember we talked last week about the difficulty with the audible? In fact, how difficult was it just from Adam to Eve and from Eve to Satan? From one to one, it already got changed. Audible, that happens. Now he says, we have a more sure word of prophecy, which is the written word of God. And notice what he says. That whereunto you do well that you take heed as unto a light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. That didn't come by the will of man. Are you listening? It didn't come. Men didn't decide what to write. God told them what to write. Holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Okay? And so God gave them. So these writings, here again, these are the writings of God. And they're to be cared for in a particular way. And God saw to it that in the Old Testament, it was the priests, and it was namely the Kohathites, as I mentioned earlier. And God's plan has always been for a specific group of people to handle His Word and to take care of His Word. In fact, next week we'll talk a little bit more about Ezekiel 44. You might just jot that down in your notes, Ezekiel 44. In Ezekiel 44, the Kohathites abandoned their responsibility, and they delegated it. And they delegated it to people who were unbelievers. They let them in it. By the way, when the Israelites decided, remember the Ark of the Covenant, the Philistines took it and they stole it. And when they decided to send it back to Israel, does anybody remember how they sent it back to Israel? Yeah, they put it on a cart. Now, remember we read earlier about the staves that went through the loops on the Ark? And God says that's how it's going to be transported. He designed for the Kohathites to be able to carry it. You'll find out in one passage in the Old Testament when Merari and the other son and then Kohathites, those two guys, Merari and his brother, they both got wagons to pull all their stuff from the tabernacle. But he said the sons of Kohath will get no wagons. You say, well, man, that's not fair. They got three wagons. We got four wagons. We don't get any wagons. Huh? No, you know why? Because God says, you're going to carry what you carry. You're carrying the most holy things, and I've already got a plan for how you transport those. And by the way, you don't do it on a new cart. And Israel found that out. The Kohathites found that out in Ezekiel 44, and we'll say more about that when we talk about them next week. In fact, God didn't just say it wasn't good. God said it was an abomination to Him to turn that responsibility over to unbelievers. And so we'll talk more about that next week. But listen, after Christ came now, that responsibility does not belong to the priests or the Kohathites. It belongs to us. It belongs to the church. Now, so what about the church? Well, the church is a prepared place. Jesus said, upon this rock, meaning Himself and meaning the confession of faith that Peter made, that He is the Christ, the Son of the living God, He said, I will build my church. That's a pretty safe place to be. Any place that Christ is the head of and Christ is building, that's a safe place to be. Okay? And it has His protection, His guarantee of being a prepared place. Then He said the church is also a holy place. A holy place. In Ephesians 5 and verse number 27, He said this, that He might present it to Himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but it should be holy and without blemish. The church is to be holy. Church is to be set apart to God. That's why you don't bring the world into the church. The church, by the very nature of the word, is set apart. It's a called out assembly. Called out from where? Called out from the world. And if we're not called out from the world, if we're bringing the world in with it, we don't live up to the name church. Maybe that's why some of the modern ones don't use the word church in their name. I don't know. But you understand, we have a responsibility that God's church be a holy church. He said it's a holy place. And then we know that the church is a safe place. What do you mean safe? Jesus said, upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Now, gates don't mean that you don't attack anybody with a gate. You don't say, Brother Woods, you better behave or I'm going to hit you with my gate. No, gates are to keep people out, isn't it? And so the idea here, the church is on the offensive. The church is on the move. We're to be aggressive. And we don't have to fear, because they're not going to prevail against us. Hey, if God be for us, who can be against us? We are more than conquerors through Him who loved us so. And so we know that it's a safe place because we're doing what God wants us to do, and we're in the place God wants us to be. You see, the church is the place from which God's power is manifested, and it's the place where God's people are motivated. It's a place where God's power is manifested and God's people are motivated. Look, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. You know what you do when you get to church? You're here to encourage somebody. You're here to motivate somebody. You're here to want to do something for God and to be encouraged to do something for God. It's motivational. The first missionaries were sent out of the church at Antioch. See, had such an atmosphere there that they knew that they ought to do something for God. And the Holy Spirit said, you separate me, Saul and Barnabas, for the work whereunto I've called them. And guess what? They did. They did what the Spirit told them to do. And by the way, that's what the church is supposed to do. The church is a sending station. The church isn't just to bring them in. The church is supposed to be sending them out. And that's part of the responsibility. So in the Old Testament days, God worked through the nation of Israel. It's most of what your Old Testament is about. He showed His power, His protection, His provision. He showed His power, His protection, His provision to the surrounding world by taking care of Israel. They saw what He did for Israel, and they knew that He was the God, and there was no other like Him. And so He gave His word to be their source of direction, their source of guidance. And He told them, as long as you obey my word, you'll be blessed. You disobey my word, and you will be cursed. I'll chastise you. Now in the New Testament, He's allowed another group of people to be the example to the surrounding world of His power and His provision, His protection. And that group of people is the church. That's how He shows the world how His power is and His protection and His involvement in our lives. And so the source of our supply, our source of guidance and direction is the Word of God. We're to follow what God says. This is the guide. This is the roadmap right here that we follow. And we follow what God says. And so God is the source and supply of God's Word has always been with God's people. He hasn't changed. It's still entrusted to us as God's people. And the act of involving outside entities to be trustees of the Word of God is an abomination to God. It is something that is extremely loathsome in His sight. And so just as He gave His word to the Jews, and particularly to the priests, the Kohathites, to protect and preserve and publish, the second group, us, all right, we've been given that same responsibility. To protect, preserve, and publish the Word of God. Now let's look at number three. The process of preserving His word through the pen. This is some phenomenal stuff here. The process of preserving His word through the pen. Anytime man gets involved with anything, there's a potential for error. Would you agree? Okay. If you want to get something messed up, just involve humans. Okay. We can do a good job of it. So with something as important as the Word of God, much care would have to be taken to preserve human error from tainting the Word of God so that it could be preserved and passed on. Now, history and some of the writings of the scribes reveal to us the steps that were taken to provide us with the Bible that we have today. All right? Now, listen carefully. The first one is A, is accuracy. Accuracy. Here's some rules that were followed to ensure that nothing was added or taken away from the text. Okay? Are you ready? Number one, underneath there, the first one, I think, is there was a word count per page. They counted every word on the page. So as the scribe sat down to copy, he had to have the exact number of words. But that's not all. Secondly, there was line duplication. You had to have the exact number of lines. Not just the exact number of words, but the exact same number of lines on the page. But that's not all. Next, there was a total page letter count. Not just the number of words on the page, not just the number of lines on the page, you had to count the number of letters. You say, why would you count the number of letters? Misspelling. So if there was so many letters on that page and you had a few less letters, somebody misspelled a word somewhere. And you go find it. The letters had to be the same. And then, and not only that, there was a middle letter test. Of all the letters on the page, they determined where the middle letter was. And when you copied, your middle letter better be exactly where the other middle letter was. That's how precise it had to be. That's how they were so concerned about accuracy. Okay, then let's go to the next one. B is format. Format. To maintain uniformity in the copy. It would be formatted the same way. All right, every column that they would write in, every column, it had to be a minimum of 48 lines, but it could not be more than 80 lines on the page. Each column had to consist of 30 letters. No word or letter was to be written from memory. You couldn't get to John 3:16 and say, okay, for God so loved the world. You couldn't do it by memory. You had to look for God, God. So. You had to write every single word. No word or letter was to be written from memory. They had to use the space of a hair or a thread between every consonant. Between every book, there had to appear three lines. In other words, remember, there's only so many lines per page, so if you ended a book and were going to start another book, you had to allow three lines, blanks, but three lines before you would start another book. Uniformity. You're not going to just feel like you start one wherever you want to. That wasn't allowed. What you're copying is going to look like just what you copied. It's going to stay the same. It isn't going to change. And then the copyist had to sit in full Jewish dress and wash his entire body. Think they were serious about the Word of God? Think they realized their awesome responsibility that was theirs to fulfill, giving it to the next generation? And then it was to be copied each letter by letter, not word for word or sentence by sentence. Letter by letter, because spelling was important. The number of letters were counted. The right letters had to be on the right part of the page. Just amazing. Amazing what people have gone through so we could have this tonight. Amazing. Let's look at C, accessibility. Are you okay? Doing all right? Accessibility. Manuscripts were limited according to how long the originals lasted from being handled. So here's what would take place. If somebody had a scroll, and they had a scroll of the Word of God here, maybe they had a scroll of 1 John, and and they would read it and use it, and maybe pass it to someone else, and they'd read it and use it. And pretty soon, when it gets passed around enough and enough people look at it, what's going to happen to this? It's going to get worn, going to get torn, going to get, and you know what? Somebody say, hey, you know what? It's time to get a copy of this. And they would start that process we're looking at right here. And they would begin to make a copy of it. And they would begin to make it exactly as this one was. And it's limited depending on how much they were handled. That's why, listen, they came up a while back with the, you know, by the way, the manuscripts that the King James Bible comes from, and all is that's the only Bible that comes from the received text. They call it the Textus Receptus, but all the other translations come from what's called the Alexandrian manuscripts that were found in a garbage can inside of a monastery in Alexandria, Egypt. That's why they're called Alexandrian. And they think, oh, these are older, and look what good condition they're in. And they're older than these other ones. Now, knowing what you know, why do you think they'd be older, and why do you think they'd be in better condition? Nobody used them. They did not accept them as the Word of God. And yet, they're passed off as the Word of God today. Okay? And so, what happens is you use them, and then they get, now we have to copy them, and then they're going to be used, they have to be copied, and it goes on like that. All right? Number two, underneath their manuscripts were limited according to the length of time it took them to be copied. How long would it take? Obviously, you're going to take longer to do Romans than you are 1 John. You're going to take longer to do the Gospel of John than you are Jude. It's going to determine how long it'll take them to copy it. Manuscripts were limited according to the cost it took to reproduce them. Jewish history reveals that with such meticulous care to detail and accuracy of duplication, the newly copied manuscripts were just as accurate and powerful as the ones they were copied from. And that process went on for centuries. Something happened in 1456. Somebody invented, a man named Gutenberg, the Gutenberg press. And he invented it, by the way, to make the Word of God accessible to every person on earth. So let's look at number four now. The process of preserving His Word through the printing press. All right? The process of preserving the Word of God through the printing press. A, they translate from the original manuscripts into the language to be printed. And let me, and obviously you understand, that's almost a misnomer. There are no original manuscripts. Okay, and I want you to know that. When someone says in the original, it says this, what they should mean, is, if they might mean, is in the original language, it means this. But nobody has an original manuscript, nor has anybody ever seen one. We have copies of the 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 originals. And we saw what detail and what care was taken to maintain them. But those aren't the originals. But you take from the manuscript, and then you want to take it into the language that you want to be printed. Now, again, we're talking now about the printing press. Okay, you think about what language you want to be printed. Whether you print it into this, what do you call that? Well, what's the language? South is... That's what I thought. And I was going to write that down as a prayer request. I thought, how do you spell Azerbaijan, whatever it is, South? I get the South part, amen? Azerbaijani? Azerbaijani. Wow. All right. You're going to print it in that language, so you take it from that into the language to be printed. Then you have to go through editing. What's that mean? You have to proof it. You have to look for mistakes. Okay? You have to make sure the right words are being used. You heard Brother Levine talk about the basket. Remember that? He said, you know, in Nepal, there were four words for basket. So when the disciples took up 12 basketfuls after the feeding of the 5,000, what word for basket are you going to use? He said, you know, they have four different words for basket. Are you going to use He said they have a one word for basket, which is like a lunch basket. Well, maybe that's what it was. After all, the boy gave his lunch. So maybe they took up 12 lunch baskets full, and each of the disciples had a lunch to take home. But wait a minute, he thought, well then, let's back up. What about that word basket in the New Testament? What is the Greek word for basket there, and is it used anywhere else in the New Testament? And they looked and they said, yeah, it's used one other time in the New Testament. And it was in the book of Acts when Paul, they let him escape out of the city, they let him over the wall in a basket. Same word as the baskets they use to collect the fragments after the feeding of the 5,000. So let me ask you this, was that a lunch basket? No, it's got to be a basket big enough to fit a man in and hold him and let him down on the wall and let him escape. So now you find out these are big baskets. And when they hauled away that day were big baskets that it probably took several people to carry. Which makes sense. He sat them down in 12 companies, I think, of 500 that day or something like that. 10 companies. No, sat them down in 50 by 50s. So you get, and so you start collecting leftovers from companies of 50. I think I get, if you divide 5,000, and that's just the men besides the women and children. So you could add as many as 10,000 there. But you have 12 disciples. You divide, you're getting all the leftovers into 12 baskets. You better have some pretty big baskets. And so you have to understand, you got to make sure that you're getting the right word when you translate into the language you're going to translate into. So editing is important. Then printing. Now, when they get that first, when they get the first draft, so to speak, of what they, maybe they'll do Mark, as you've heard them say, they're doing Mark and what's the other New Testament book? It was one of the epistles, I thought. Philippians. That's what I was going to say. Mark and Philippians. Well, then listen, they'll get those, and they may do a printing of those, or like they may do a John and a Romans, or but they'll do a printing of those, and then let's just a smaller printing and let people read them. Is it readable? The people in their language, and do they see any problems? Do they see any corrections that should be made? Something that isn't quite right. And you're going to do that, and then you're going to go to D, the revision. You'll print correcting any mistakes found by the small group by that first small printing that you did. And once that is done, you go to E, which is mass production. That means you're printing in large quantities to be distributed. Large quantities to be distributed. And the last thing you have, F, is distribution. Get the word of God out. Haggai 2:19, interesting verse. He asked the question, is the seed yet in the barn? Let me ask you a question. Is the seed do any good when it's in the barn? Where does the seed have to be? It's got to be in the ground. It's got to be sown. It has to get out. And it's not going to do any good if the seed just stays in the barn. We have to, it's our responsibility to get the seed out. People are born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible seed by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. Why is it that so many of those billions of people, listen carefully, why so many of those billions of people or millions of people are not born again and have turned to Islam instead of turning to Christ? Because we have not given them the seed of the Word of God. Japan, they said the other night, is Shintoism. Japan, 80%. I'm told at the end of World War II, General MacArthur said, give me 10,000 missionaries to go to Japan. It's ripe for the gospel. And America did not do it. So Japan isn't anywhere near a Christian nation. We're sending missionaries to Japan. So let's not keep the seed in the barn. We have to distribute it. sadly, 560 years roughly since the invention of the first printing press, that statement, the seed's still in the barn, is still the same. The scriptures could potentially be available for every person on earth, but it is not. We have not obtained that purpose yet. There's much work to be done. There's much work to be done. And we have a part in achieving that goal. Okay? You will find out next week from the Bible what your part is. Okay? Don't miss it. Don't miss it. You'll need to hear that. Next week will be God's people for providing His word to every generation. If it's your responsibility, you ought to know what it is. When the policeman turns his lights on and you pull over to the side of the road, and he asks you the question, do you know how fast you were going? And you have that instant where you think, do I tell the truth or do I make something up? Right? But let me ask you a question. If you say, or if he asked you, do you know what the speed limit is on this road? And you say, no, I have no idea. Does he then say, oh, well, that makes a difference? No. He says, if you're driving the car, you're supposed to know what the speed limit is on the road. Is ignorance an excuse? It is not. So you're going to find out we have a responsibility in providing God's word to every generation. You say, I'm just not going to come next week, so I won't know about it. Is ignorance an excuse? It is not. So make sure you're here. Let's find out what our responsibility is. Amen? Let's stand together. We'll have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you now for tonight. Thank you, Lord, for everyone's attention this evening. Thank you, Lord, for the precious word of God. Well, thank you for the amazing, as I look at this, the amazing dedication, devotion, the ones who understood the awesome responsibility that was theirs to be entrusted with the Word of God. Oh Lord, impress upon us our responsibility. And help us not keep the seed in the barn, but help us to go and to go forth and to scatter the seed of the Word of God. Lord, I pray that not only with the ministries that we have, whether it's the prison and the RU program and the bus route and the soul winning, but Lord, everywhere we go, that we would spread the Word of God. We would leave a trail of seed as we go about our daily duties. That you would prosper it. For you promised that your word would never return void, but it would accomplish the purpose for which it was sent forth. So, Lord, I pray you'll dismiss us now with your care and your blessing, and make us mindful of your presence as we leave this place tonight. Thank you again for being our God. We're so glad we are your people. Use us now for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hey, let's sing. Isn't He wonderful? Wonderful, wonderful. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Let me hear you sing. Isn't He wonderful? Wonderful, wonderful. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard, it's recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? God bless you. You are dismissed.